Hello and welcome to UK Theme Parks. My name's Adam, and in this very special episode, we are launching our campaign for better planning. By what we mean by better planning is that the theme park day out is supposed to be a joyous, amazing occasion, either for yourself, with friends, in groups, or indeed with your family. And planning plays a massive part in what you do throughout the day. Now, we believe that planning is one of the most important aspects of it, and you can't just rock up to these theme parks and, you know, potentially have a great day, especially when the park is busy. Now, the idea of this is we've seen and have personal experience where theme park days out or any days out have gone terribly wrong, whether it be ride closures, whether it be arriving late, whether it be not packing the right equipment, whether it be not packing the right clothes. There are so many aspects that people don't necessarily consider, not through fault of their own, but maybe through lack of experience in visiting parks. We want to make sure that everyone going to a theme park has an amazing time. We have an amazing time at theme parks. We've been doing it for 27 years, and we want to share some of that experience with you in this video today. So this is it. This is where the campaign begins in this video. However, it's not going to stop there. In the links below, you will see a link to our Facebook page where we want your suggestions. What you do on your days out, things we haven't picked up on, things you do that make your life a lot easier and make your family's or your group's day much more enjoyable. You'll also see a link where everything is detailed down. So we have a detailed guide on our website of the plans that we've listed here and indeed any great suggestions that come up on our Facebook page. We want this to be the definitive guide to planning your day at the theme park. We understand that, you know, when you're with families and things, sometimes trips out can be quite difficult and quite stressful. We just want to take that away. We want to help you take that away, and we want you to help us to make everyone's life much easier. So let me tell you now, this video is going to be quite definitive. We're not going to put bullet points as we go because we don't want you having to write them all down and trying to remember things. They will be in the link below. So make sure you can just listen, soak in some ideas, visit the link later, plan your day before you go. It's broken down into many, many aspects, from before you go to why you're there, and perhaps even once you're finished as well. There's lots of things you need to consider, no matter how many of you are visiting. Even if you're visiting on your own, there are plenty of things you can do to enhance your day. So we're going to start today with selecting the right park. Now, this might sound really, really basic, but selecting the right park is easily going to have a massive impact on your day out. Obviously, if you're selecting Fort Park when you've got a 2 and a 4 year old, you're not going to have as good a day as what you would do perhaps at Legoland or Chessington or Paulsons Park or one of the family based parks. So it's highly important that you check what you want to be doing during the day. Now, there are families of different age groups, and Fort Park, as we used an example, does cater for some younger customers. However, it is predominantly a thrill park, so you need to make sure that you are selecting the park correctly, not just one you've seen on the news, not just one you've kind of seen in publicity, not one you've seen kind of in a magazine or something. You need to make sure you are going there because it suits your needs, not necessarily suits their needs. Highly important. Once you've selected your park, you then need to find the best value ticket. Now, the best value ticket is never on the day. Rock up to any theme park, you will pay the most money possible. So you need to, again, plan this in advance. Now, there are several ways of doing this. Most theme parks offer a book online service. Book online service will undoubtedly be cheaper. Sometimes it's cheaper the further in advance you book. So again, the further you plan, the more money off you'll get. So Blackpool Pleasure Beach, for instance, tend to do a better ticket if you offer 10 days in advance. Certainly the Merlin Parks is more 7 days in advance. And you'll see on the website what value they can offer. And you'll usually save up to 40% by booking online. There may be discount codes. So one of our local parks down in Adventure Wonderland in Bournemouth is currently doing a 3-for-2 offer. Flamingoland are currently doing a 3-for-2 offer, and you can get various other offers online. Not advertised on a website, not advertised kind of locally, but through voucher websites. So it's definitely worth having a look at this as well. Type it in, see what comes up, see what offers work, see what best suits your family or yourself or your group when you're visiting. And then, of course, there are 2-for-1 vouchers. Now, this is predominantly the Merlin parks that do the 2-for-1 vouchers. You'll get them off cereal packets, you might get them off sweet wrappers, you can get them off absolutely everything. And these do work out very good value for money if you are visiting in, obviously, nominations of 2, 4, 6, 8, etc. These tend to be the best value because when you're looking at £50 entry and you're looking at £25 then per person by using a buy one, get one free, where perhaps it might be £27, £28 by booking online. So it's definitely worth doing that. You have to bear in mind you will have to get your ticket on the day and you won't be able to book it in advance. However, might work out slightly cheaper. So now you've bought your ticket and you're all ready for your theme park journey, see whether or not you need to pay for car parking. Now the Merlin parks are the worst at this, where you will end up paying to park your car for the day, as well as entering their park and various other bits and pieces. We are strongly against this, however, it's a fact of lifestyle. Then you go to America, you all have to pay for parking over there. Get the ticket in advance. Again, this is something else that, you know, if you haven't been able to book online, you are doing a 2-for-1 voucher. When you walk into the park, buy the ticket. Alton Towers have machines, I believe Fort Park as well. You can get them from any of their admission kiosks at any point during the day. Buy the ticket early, don't be getting it on the way out when everyone else is. So once you've picked your park and you've bought your ticket, so you know you're definitely going, you need to plan ahead for your day at that park. Now then, this includes looking at the rides. Which rides do you want to go on? This includes measuring your children if you're with a family. Now, measure them accurately. Don't measure them in kind of, oh, I think you'll be that, stand on your tiptoes, because when you get to the theme parks, they will measure them 100% accurate. There is no point in moaning or, you know, having a go at people if your child comes up 1 or 2 centimeters short. Now, I can tell you it's happened in my experience. My 8-year-old now is 1.38, which is highly frustrating when I want to take him on Nemesis, but he can't go on it yet. And you just kind of have to respect for the safety aspect. So again, make sure you measure them accurately so you're not over-promising rides. They can have a look what they can go on. They can get excited about what's going on. If you're going by yourselves, again, you may want to miss the smaller rides. You may just want to concentrate on the larger rides. So kind of have a plan in your head of what rides you'd like to go on. Download the map to your phone. Now, most of the maps can be found on the park's website, which you can download in PDF format and you can download in JPEG format. This isn't just for planning ahead, this is also for planning on the day. There's nothing worse than walking around with a piece of paper all day necessarily when you don't have to. Most people have their phones out. Most people will use them for planning, most people use them for various other activities. It's not likely to get lost, you're likely to have it on you all the time. And the map on there is, you know, you can zoom in, you can have a close look, it's not taking up loads of space. It's a great idea to have on your phone. Now, some parks do have apps as well. Again, your main Merlin parks will have apps. You could download those. They'll give you queue times. They'll give you where to eat. They'll give you lots of information on the app which you can access during the day. Quite simply, make the most out of it. Make the most out of what the parks offer you, because you'll easily find information out. You won't have to hunt around for it, and it'll be much easier on the day. That said, make sure your phone is charged. And this may sound very silly, but the amount of people that play with their phone on the way to theme parks, get inside of theme parks, and then wonder why they only have 50%, make sure your phone is charged. If you can take a charger and you think you're going to need one, take a charger with you. There's many portable chargers out. I'm sure you own one. We certainly own several for our ventures out. So just make sure you're prepared and that everything is ready. Think about how you want to eat at the park. Now, you know, 95% of the time when we visit theme parks, we don't eat hot food. This is for two reasons. Price, although the park obviously like you to buy it because it will help them. You know, it is priced, it is quite costly when there's a family going. So have a little think about that. And also, when you're obviously buying hot food at the park, you can expect to queue for the hot food, have to eat the hot food, and it's going to take an hour, possibly an hour and a half out of your day. Now, some people pack sandwiches, some people pack lunch, some people will eat at the park. If you're a group, you can probably eat it on the go. You know, when I'm on my own, I eat lots of hot dogs at the park. I eat them as I go. Don't tell my children, they don't know. I don't let them buy them when we go. I claim I never have them. That aside, think about what you want to do. If you can take a packed lunch is obviously a great option. You can take snacks, you can take drinks. They're quite expensive to buy at the park. You probably wouldn't want to do so if you're on a budget. If you're not, it's not going to matter so much. But just plan ahead, plan what you want to do. You can go without hot food until the park's closed and get something on the way home, or if you're quite close to the park, that's easily the best way. You will definitely make the most out of rides and attractions and anything there is to see and show wise at the park, and it's a great way of going. Now then, a really silly one again, before you arrive at the park, check the weather. Now this can usually be done the day before to get an accurate reading of what's going on. It may seem common sense, but a lot of people forget to check the weather. You know, once you've booked your ticket, you're under the impression you're going regardless of the weather, which is true. You will be going regardless of the weather. However, you can prepare accordingly. There's nothing worse than getting to a theme park, finding out it's 28, 30 degrees and having no sun cream, particularly if you have a family. You know, it's not good enough these days to just sun cream up in the mornings. You need to reapply during the day, and we see a lot of burnt people at theme parks as the day goes on. And we've been caught out before. You know, these tips are from personal experience, and we've been caught out before. The one we get caught out with the most, undoubtedly, is rain or wet. Now, what we mean by rain is rain. So if you know it's going to rain, you need to take appropriate clothing and you need to be prepared to get wet. It's also worth taking a spare pair of clothes, which perhaps you leave in the car or carry around with you, just in case you need to change at any point and you do get that wet. Now, there's also water rights to consider. So if you're going to Oakwood and you want to go on Drenched, or you're going to Blackpool, you want to go in Valhalla, or indeed you want to go to Tidal Wave at Foot Park, you're going to get wet. So you have to make a decision on the, you know, beforehand. Do I want to get wet? Do I want to be in wet clothes all day? Can I pack a spare pair of clothes that I can change into quickly? Is it going to be a hot day? Am I going to drive off? Do I really want to go on that ride? Yes, I do want to go on that ride. These are, it seems really petty, but they are great things to kind of plan in advance. We've been to Fort Park many, many times and missed Tidal Wave because we're not prepared. We're not prepared to sit in soaking wet clothes for the day. Sadly, when we go to Blackpool, it happens quite a lot as well. We're just not prepared to go on Valhalla because of the weather and our travel and everything else. So have a think about it. See what water rides they've got. You've got to assume on a water ride, if you've never been to the theme park, you're going to get wet of some description. Obviously, rides named Tidal Wave, you know you're going to get very wet, and indeed on the name's Drench. So you can think of that one in advance. Talking about clothes, for sensible footwear. We've seen people at theme parks with high heels, which is baffling at the best. You know, even sandals are a little bit of a push when you've got to do quite a lot of walking. Now, it's not for us to tell you what to wear, but common sense would probably say you're going to be doing a lot of walking. There might be some dangle down rides, so you know, your Vampires, your Nemesis, your Infernos, you know, Vortex, and even rides like that where your feet are going to be exposed, you may not want to leave your shoes on the side. You may want to have shoes that perhaps stay on your feet for the duration of this to make sure you don't lose your shoes at any point. So just think about your footwear before you go. Sometimes it's nice to wear something fashionable, but ideally you should probably wear something comfortable. That's certainly our tip anyway, and that's certainly what we do. So if you're taking your family to a theme park and you've got some young children, you need to consider the fact that perhaps they may get lost throughout the day. Now, no one likes a missing child, and you certainly wouldn't want to be losing your child, but it has happened to most of us. Now then, there are things you can do. When you get to the theme park, you can head to guest services and you can have a wristband or some kind of descriptive telephone number put somewhere on your child. That said, this is quite time consuming. And again, if you want to enjoy your day out and you want to make the most of it, when you get to the theme park, the last thing you want to be doing is going to guest services. Now, certainly what we've done in the past is we've not put a bit of paper or something on a child which they could lose. We've actually written the telephone number and either mum or dad in the tag of their clothing. Now, theme parks should really look for this because certainly names of childs tends to be written on their clothes in their tagging, because you do it for school, you may do it for bags and various other bits and pieces. So what we tend to do is we tend to have theme park clothes for the children. We'll write the telephone number on there, we'll make sure it's perfectly visible before we go to the theme park, and we'll write mum, dad on top, because generally the child will remember its own name. This is a great time-saving exercise, if you will. You know, once your telephone number's on there, perhaps your child can remember the telephone number is there. You know, what's mummy and dad's telephone number, or it's on my tag. A lot of them will remember some sort of free upwards. You know, we do hope you obviously don't lose your children at theme parks. It's not something I wish on anyone. It's a horrible experience. I've seen it. I've been involved in it. But just prepare yourself, just in case. So if you've decided you're not going to eat at the park in terms of hot food, make sure you pack the right food for your family, or indeed yourself, or indeed your group. You know, it's not for us to tell you what to pack, but just make sure you're prepared. Make sure you've got plenty of fluids. Make sure you've got some snacky bits. They're quite handy to have during queue lines. And, you know, nothing too heavy that you're going to be carrying around with all day. So, a massive part, get to the theme park early. I cannot stress this enough, get to the theme park early. Now, we don't mean that when the theme park opens at 10 o'clock, you rock up at 9:55. We mean early. Now, we have this discussion with many people. Many people have come to us and say, "Oh, what's your biggest tip for the day? What can we do? What should we look out for?" This is it. This is the single biggest tip. Get to the park early. Now, more people are taking advantage of this. More people are getting to the park early. However, you will still be shocked that if you go out to your car at sort of 12, half past 12, that people are still arriving to a nearly full theme park. There's lots of things you need to consider when going to the theme park. One, a lot of the theme parks open the gates slightly earlier. Certainly the Merlin ones do. You have early ride at Alton Towers where you can get in at 9 o'clock. Thought Park tend to let you in a little bit earlier. Chessington let you into the theme park sort of up to half an hour earlier. Even though the rides may not be open in some cases, you can get to where you want to be ready for when the rides do open, which is huge when you consider the amount of people that would be there had you rocked up at 10 o'clock. But there are other things you have to consider. You know, once you've got to the theme park, you need to get out of your car after parking it. Parking it is, you know, absolutely fundamental, and sometimes can be, you know, queue-based right the way out to the entrance of the park if you don't arrive at the right time. So getting there at a good time and parking, you need to take this into account on timings. Getting to the entrance, get tickets if you need to get tickets. So if you haven't booked online, you're going for the 2-for-1 offer, you're going to have to queue with everyone else to get tickets because people will also be doing that. You have to get through security at most parks now. Some parks are worse than others, but you'll go through bag searches, you'll go through wanding, you'll be in a long queue to do so before you even get to the turnstiles to kind of enter the park. You need to take this into account on your timings in the morning. And you know, you want to get into the park and get somewhere close to the front of the line on your first ride. You know, it's absolutely fundamental, whichever park you're going to, that you do this. Going back to preparing yourself, remember, when you park your car, take a picture of where you've parked your car. Now, we all like to think we've got great memories. I certainly like to think I've got a great memory. It's an utter lie. I have a terrible memory. It's just not worth talking about. That said, take a picture of your car, because at the end of the day, if you've had a great day and a fun day, we're talking 8 or 9 hours later. The chances of you remembering where your car is, even a letter on the wall or on a massive post somewhere, very, very slim. The other thing we've seen people do is tie bags to the top of their aerials so they can just point around and kind of see where their car is. It's not a bad idea. You might be a bit screwed if a lot of people do that, but generally people don't think of these things in advance. You know, some people have fluffy toys, some people have other bits and pieces on top of their car, but make sure you remember where you park your car. There's going to be nothing worse than coming out of theme park after a great day and not being able to find your car. So when we talk about getting to the park early, see if the park does do an early rider. Now, pretty much early rider seems to be limited to Alton Towers if you've booked in advance and the park opens at 9 o'clock. Again, remember if you're going to Alton Towers, the parking monorail to entrance can be anywhere up to 40 minutes. So if you want to get into the park for 9 o'clock and you rock up at 10 to 9, it's just not going to happen. You're going to miss out on timings. But check if the park do it. Check whether or not there's any extra rides open. See how much it is. See whether or not you can get on it on the ticket you're buying. It may sway you between a 2-for-1 voucher or indeed buying online, but certainly worth a look. Now then, whilst we have encouraged you to pack lunches and various other bits, try to take as little into the park as possible. You need to remember you'll be carrying this around all day. You know, if you've got a buggy, you'll be wheeling there around all day, particularly when your child gets out and your buggy becomes back heavy. We've all done it, we've all been there, and we've all had that problem. Take as least in as possible, even if you're with a group. You know, if you're with a group of adults and you don't need to be taking bags in, you know, you don't need to look good, you don't need your makeup or anything like that, make sure you take the bare essentials. Telephone, perhaps, you know, card, money, that's it. That's all you really need to take in. Carrying big bags around with other bits in just kind of slows down the day process. If you don't need it, don't take it. For families doing it, and this is something we do quite a lot, go through your bag. The more places you visit, the more clutter ends up in your bag. And if you're anything like me, you'll just leave it to clutter and clutter and clutter until one day you look at it and think, is there actually anything in there I need? And the chances are there won't be anything in there you need. So just make sure you go through your bag first. Make it as light as possible. Put in there what you need, you know, your essentials for your family or for your group for the day. So once you're inside the park, hopefully you've made a plan of which way you want to go. Don't go to the most popular ride first. Now, however tempting it is that you might want to walk into Thought Park and head straight to Swarm, try not to do it. Or Saw, because that's another popular one first. Try not to do it. Try to start at the back of the park in most circumstances. Depending on what park you've gone to will depend on which order you could go around in it. You know, if you arrive at Chessington and head down to the Vampire, chances are you'll be queuing for the Vampire at 45 minutes at 10 o'clock, and by the time you come off, everything will be absolutely rammed. We do Chessington a lot, so we're going to use Chessington as an example here for the first time. We walk into Chessington, we will queue for Dragon's Fury first. Now, it is one of the big rides and it is by the entrance. However, the throughput, in terms of how many people can ride it per hour, is terrible. So the earlier you can get on it, the better. And the chances are, if you've arrived at the park and you've gone through your security and you're in there at 9:30, 9:20, 9:30, and you can go straight and queue for it, 9 times out of 10, probably even 49 out of 50, it opens at 10 o'clock on time and you can get on it. Sometimes we've been known for the ride to open early rather than at 10 o'clock, which is even more of a bonus. Now, if you get straight on it and you're in the first couple of people, you'll notice when you get off it, there is a massive queue behind you. So this is definitely one that we do first, every single time without fail. If the ride's not likely to be open at 10 o'clock, staff are usually very good to say the ride will be late, and then you have to make an executive decision what to do. Now from here, we travel into Wild Asia. We will do Cobra next, because that also gets quite big queues. We'll do the Dojums, the Tuk Tuk Thermal, and we'll do the Wave Swinger, which is the Monkey Swinger. And we'll do those four rides before 11 o'clock, without a doubt. We will then walk around to Mystic East, and we will do the Dragon Falls ride, which is the park's log flume. We will then walk from there and go straight to Toon Blaster. We will come out of Toon Blaster and head down to Sufari, which tends to open at 12 o'clock. We'll come off Sufari, do Scorpion Express, by which point we will think about lunch. Now, it seems quite a lot, but these rides can easily be done. You know, you can pick up other rides in the middle quickly in terms of Ramesses Revenge and the Flying Jumbos. You can pick up those really, really quickly. Now, for my children and my height, these rides are perfect. You know, if you have younger children, you may want to do a slightly different route, obviously, because you may want to go into Land of the Dragons with Griffin's Galleon, or indeed Sea Dragons, or perhaps Toadie's Crazy Cars and Tiny Truckers. But for us, this is the route. We will have something very quickly to eat, sandwich, packet of crisps. We will then head down and do the Gruffalo, because the Gruffalo queue moves very, very fast. We'll come out of Gruffalo and do Vampire. Undoubtedly, Vampire will have a long queue, usually 45 minutes to an hour. That said, by the time you've got down to it, bearing in mind it's on early rider in the morning, as we said, it tends to have a 45 minute to an hour queue then. During the lunchtime hours, this will be between 1 and 2, it is the quietest time to ride the Vampire, apart from at the end of the day. So it's the time we do it. We can come off Vampire, wait 10 minutes for Black Buccaneer, wait 20 minutes for Sea Storm, and that's us pretty much done. We take in the shows, we take in the zoos, and this is tried and tested for us and how it works. You know, this is an example, it's not for gospel. You know, you go to Autumn Towers, you would probably start with Nemesis, which is on early rider. You may want to hang around then for Galactica to open at 10 rather than head over to Oblivion. There are other, you know, there are many ways to do, but try not to head to the most popular ride first. It is what everyone else does. Generally, they can't resist doing it. And it does usually cause you to then have a backlog throughout the day because you're just following the crowds rather than going against the crowds. Now then, it is very important that you stick to your game plan and not kind of change it unless you absolutely have to. And what we mean by changing it is the fact that there may be some ride closures, or there may be something that breaks down while you're in the queue line. You may even be evacuated from the queue line. You need to try and stick to your plan. You will have a much better day than dwelling on what could have been. We've all been there. We've all had times where rides have closed and we've been frustrated and we stand in queue lines and various bits. And you know, the biggest complaints we hear from parks, if you go on the Facebook pages, the biggest complaints you hear is, we didn't get on this ride, we didn't do this, we only rode two rides throughout the day. Now, even on the busiest day at some of the busiest theme parks, if you've only ridden two rides, you did not get there early enough or you did not stay late enough. I'm really sorry, but it is as simple as that. You know, we've been to theme parks on some of the busiest times, fright nights, you know, the height of summer, and we've still managed to do a minimum of 6 or 7 big rides. So try and stick to your plan. It is incredibly frustrating when things go wrong, but you have to consider that, you know, by the time you've gone down to, you know, if things are going wrong, by the time you've gone down to customer care, the kind of complaints area, and you've waited in line and you've made a complaint, you wait for them to go, we're really sorry about that. Even if they give you a fast track or a fast pass or wherever, you know, the time you spent queuing, the anger you've built up queuing, you know, and the fact you've made either your group or your family wait around for it, it will ruin your day. You know, if you feel like you need to complain afterwards, by all means, the parks kind of welcome the feedback. You know, complain in the right way, the chances are you'll still get something from them. Don't go in there looking for something from them, because if you queue an hour and you don't get anything from them, it's going to be even more of a waste and you're going to be even more upset. So try and stick to your plan best you can. Unless you really feel you have to go there, try and avoid it and just move on to the next ride. Keep finding rides that are open, and again, you'll get on more rides as the day goes on. Fast track is of course an option. We don't buy fast track. It's a money thing. You know, we get frustrated by how much it's sold in the parks, particularly the Merlin ones. However, you know, if you have the money, fast track is an obvious option. You know, it does alleviate some of the planning, certainly some of the planning we're going through now. However, it'd be wrong not to mention it. It's a massive part of the park, and we understand why people do it. you know, it shaves about a third off your time. So again, if you've got an hour queue and you're still waiting half an hour, you've done well. Whether you think you have or not, you've done well. But you tend to get on a lot quicker, which is a lot of people's frustrations. But you know, they are posted on the website. You can get certain value bundles. They sell it around the park. You can pick your time slots. You can perhaps plan your day a little bit better with Fast Track, but you will pay for the privilege. So, most importantly, you must be prepared to queue. Unless you're going on an off-peak day during like late September on a Wednesday or something like that, you're going to be queuing. Now then, if you are going on off-peak day, I'm not really sure why you're watching this because you probably don't need to do any planning, everything will be walk-on. But assuming you are going on a busy day or a busy weekend day, make sure you're prepared. You know, if you've got children, like I have, you know, they will need things to do in the queue line. Now, mine play Pokemon Go. They frustrate me with that. They watch videos. They even fight amongst themselves, which does my head in. However, they do keep themselves entertained and keep themselves to themselves. If you're not prepared for this, you will get the I'm bored and you will get the messing around and you will get kind of problems. It's same for if you're in a group. You know, think about games like Heads Up. It may look stupid you playing it in a theme park queue, but the interaction you'll get from other people will be huge. It's worth a go. You know, music is a great one not to kill your phone battery too much. Preloaded music, not streaming so much. You know, if you can turn your internet off for these points, you can. You know, enjoy queue lines, so can children with a little bit of music. But there will be times you need a queue. However quick you get to rides and however, you know, fast you are in the mornings, by the time the afternoon rolls around, you are going to be queuing for some rides. So we touched on lunch a little bit earlier. Now, we tend to have our lunch between 12 and 1 before moving on to the other rides. We don't spend between 12 and 1 having lunch. We spend about 10 minutes. That said, you know, you may need longer. If you've got a family or you want to sit down, you may need longer to have lunch. Now, most people at theme parks have lunch between 1 and 2 as a general rule. So you have to factor this into where people will be when you want to go and queue. However, between 12 and 2 is generally a slightly quieter time for the big rides because this is when people are thinking about not being in the queue lines and indeed preparing for lunch, which most of them haven't done, and they're just kind of going from shop to shop looking to see what they want. So something we tend to do after lunch as well, we said at, you know, at Chessington we'll do Gruffalo and then we'll do Vampire, and you know, is perhaps look at some of the park shows. So if you don't want to go straight on rides, straight after having lunch, you know, this is when you factor in the park shows. Whether it be at Chessington again for Sea Lion shows, you also get these at Pleasurewood Hills, you get these as well at Flamingoland. Flamingoland's got a lovely zoo you could look around at this point. You know, think about some of the things that aren't going to churn your stomach or indeed your family or group stomach at this point, and perhaps plan those in for after lunch because you probably don't want to miss them. These are exciting shows, these are other attractions which the park offer. They want you to experience them, and it's certainly worth experiencing most of them. But think about it after lunch. It's a great time for your lunch to go down, and indeed you still continue to experience the park without adding extra queue to your day. Now then, the bigger theme parks operate as long as you're in the queue, your ride policy. Now this is worth remembering, certainly at Merlin Parks, it doesn't always happen at smaller parks. You must remember that some of the smaller parks will close the queue line. You know, if they think there's a half hour queue and they shut at 5, they'll close the queue line at 4:30. But certainly at the Merlin Parks, you know, if the park closes at 5 o'clock, you can walk into that queue line right the way up to 5:01. Definitely worth remembering, you know, if you've gone all the rides you want to go on, you think, oh, you know, I'd love to go on Soar again, and it's got a 30-40 minute queue at 5:05, not a problem, you'll get in the queue. And the best part is as well, at the end of the day, is much like at the beginning. So Fast Track at the beginning of the day doesn't run till 11 o'clock, generally. Again, we're looking at Merlin Parks here. Some other parks operate differently, but certainly in most of the theme parks that offer some kind of fast pass service, it doesn't kick in till 11 o'clock, because it gets the opportunity for people to come in, buy the tickets, kind of see what the park's like, find where they can buy the tickets, decide what rides they want to go on and get the Fast Track. Same operates at the end of the day. Tends to be if the park closes at 5 o'clock, the Fast Track stops at 4:30. So come 5 o'clock, you are literally in the queue with people that are going on the ride. There aren't going to be any extras coming up. There aren't going to be any kind of groups of people sneaking through the Fast Track. These are going to be the people that are going on ride. And naturally, when Fast Track isn't merging into the queue, it moves a lot faster. So not only will you get to go on the ride quite late, you'll also get on it a lot quicker than advertised, the chances are. So worth remembering, the ride doesn't close until the park closes at most parks. But again, check, you know, ask the staff members through the day. If you're not sure on a smaller park and they turn around and say, you know, if it's got a half hour queue, we'll shut a half hour beforehand, you need to think about this. If you want to go back on a bigger ride, take it into account, have a look at the queue time. Many parks have queue times around. If you've got the app, a lot of them have it on the app. Plan it in. You don't want to miss an extra ride at the end of the day. So, you may want to buy something at the theme park. We like to buy a little bit of merchandise occasionally, and some of the shops are absolutely amazing. So why would you want to miss out? However, do it at the end of the day. This is something that you'd have to carry around. It's very tempting when you get off a ride. It always happens when I get off the Derren Brown's Ghost Train. I always see something new in the shop that I want to buy, and I just kind of have to resist for just a short period because I think, oh, I've got to have that in my pocket all day. You don't want it in your pocket, your bag, your buggy, your cool bag, whatever, all day long. So just have a little think. You know, if you see stuff around, and again, maybe take a photo of what building it's in. If you're not familiar with the park, take a photo of what building it's in. At least then if you have to ask a staff member, it's not in the main shop, you can say, right, I took a photo of this outside the building, where is it? They'll point you in the right direction. But look to get it towards the end of the day. This is something you'll have to be carrying around. It might not be something you want to miss out on. You know, if you're going for ride photos, a lot of the rides have ride photos. Again, it's something to look at probably when you arrive at the park, but you'll see it take a little flash and you'll see a photo afterwards. A lot of them have photo passes, which they'll sell you on a desk, so you can get 6 for a certain price, 5 for a certain price, 4 for a certain price, you know, a couple for a certain price. There's so many bundles, it's worth remembering. But if you buy these, you don't have to take them with you. Most of the theme parks will have a collection service much closer to the entrance than where the ride is. So again, ask the question, you know, if I buy this now, can I pick it up later? Yes, you can pick it up from here. Usually they take it up there after sort of 3-4 o'clock and you can get it on your way out. Now then, we all know you've got your car parking ticket ready. Just remember you need to get out the car park. So particularly if you're leaving at the end of the day, there might be a queue jam to get out. So that's it. That is our tips to help you plan your day at a theme park. We are starting a campaign on this right now. We want to make sure that everyone visiting a theme park is getting best value for money and have an amazing day out. There is nothing more frustrating when we see people that we think, oh God, if you'd have just done this, you'd have done this, you might have had a better day. There's no guarantee it's gonna work, but we wanna help and we want you to help as well. As we said, the links are below. Head over to our Facebook page. It's gonna be our pinned post for at least the next month heading up to Halloween. We want your suggestions, we want your ideas. We will have a page running on our Theme UK website, our UK theme parks website. And you can go on there, you can see the tips that we've gone through on the video today to save making footnotes and everything. And any great tips that come up on our Facebook page will be added, we promise, to this page. And this will be our definitive one. My name's Adam. I thank you very much for joining us on this show. We do hope it's been a help and we look forward to hearing from you in the future. Join in, be part of the community. It's your adventure, make it count.